Good morning, Church on the Hill. We are so glad you are here with us today. We are the Trotman family.
Today is Mother's Day. For some of you, this is a happy day, and for others, today will be difficult. We recognize that motherhood is many things. It's sacred and complicated, joyful and hard. Many of you are sacrificing daily for your children, and you are as exhausted as you are fulfilled.
There are women who long to be mothers but have faced the heartbreaking reality of infertility and loss. There are mothers with arms full and mothers who have had to let go. Those of you mourning your own mothers and those of you with broken relationships with your moms. There are mothers with grandchildren, foster moms, adoptive moms, and bereaved moms. Children with no mothers and mothers with no children. No matter where today finds you, we want you to know that you belong here. We honor your love, we recognize your sacrifice, and we hold space for all that motherhood means to you. And we know that Jesus will meet you right here to offer comfort, hope, and best of all, his presence in the middle of your circumstances.
Happy Mother's Day. Grab your coffee and let's get started.
Welcome to Church on the Hill. Wherever you are, at home, all around the area, please sing along with us.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things.
Yeah.
He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God. You have done great things. We dance your freedom, awaken the light. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Have done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You freed every captive and breaked every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh gosh, you two babies. God has done great things. That's why we praise his name. We're going to sing a new song this morning, and it's speaking to the fact that our God is better than anything we could ever experience on this earth. The chorus goes like this. Sing this with me as you get the hang of it. It's pretty easy, so sing along. So there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. We sing that again. There's nothing better, Lord. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. As I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and presence are never enough. And you came along and you put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. We sing, there's nothing better, Lord. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain, he's the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, Lord, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. There's nothing better. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. Give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. So there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. We sing you turn graves into gardens. Turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. Seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Amen. Father, we praise you this morning, Lord, because you are better than anything we can experience, God. We trust that, we believe that, and we know that you are better than everything we chase that does not matter compared to you, Lord. You are better. And we thank you for that truth. We praise your name and your name alone. We pray all this in your precious name. Amen.
Hi, we're the Cologne family. I'm Matt.
I'm Katie.
And this is Daniel.
And today we wanted to wish the moms out there a happy Mother's Day. Yes, Sophia?
Can I go outside?
You can go outside in a little bit.
Okay.
All right. Today we wanted to wish the moms a very happy... Yes, Evelyn?
Can you help me with my math, please?
I can help you with your math in just a little while.
Okay.
We wanted to wish the moms out there a happy Mother's Day.
Today we'll be reading from Psalm 19, verses 7 and 8 and 10 and 11. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes.
They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great reward.
So grab your notes and join us in today's message.
Welcome back. Glad that we are together again. Let's start with this. Happy Mother's Day. To all you moms out there, we would... love to honor you. So, hey, listen, if you're in a room with a mom right now, just turn to her, give her a little high five, or if she's healthy enough, you can totally hug her, mug her, like dog pile on her right now. Just go for it. Don't hurt her. Don't spill her coffee, all right? Or you might want to play it a little more cool, just kind of give her one of those, hey, mom, a head nod. Just thanks for giving me life, whatever. Moms, we celebrate you today. I hope your families do a great job of that. Hey, next week, I want to bring this to your attention. We have our anniversary celebration. As a church, we're celebrating 170 years of being a church. That is so big. There's not a lot of churches that can celebrate that kind of party. Now, listen, we planned one big service for all to come together, have lunch on the patio. Yeah, we'll do that next year, but we'll at least have a great celebration online together. We do just want to celebrate that God has made a way for this church for 170 years. And we want to ask that God might bless us for another years going forward, for however long he might bless us for. But we know this, that God has made a way for us to be a church in this valley, bringing hope, life, and truth to people. So we're going to celebrate that. I hope you'll join us. Based off of next week's celebration, we're going to launch a brand new series called Made a Way, where we're going to look at the book of Exodus, how God made a way for his people out of Egypt. And if God can make a way for them out of Egypt, he can make a way for his people right now out of quarantine. He can make a way for his people out of loss, out of financial desperation. And he can make a way for our church to have a great future. And the next chapter of the story of this church in this valley can be great. God can make a way. That's the new series that we're going to have going forward. But today, here's what I want to do. Part of that journey is going to be us utilizing a tool for the journey. So today, this is going to be a little different. It's going to feel a little more seminary than it is sermony. But I want to do this so that I can hand you a tool that could change your life. But we're definitely going to use it for the couple of months that we're going to be walking through the book of Exodus. So today is a setup for the next couple of months. Now, here's the deal. You're going to get an opportunity to engage in today, and it's going to require your effort. So I'm not going to apologize for that. You're going to have to engage in this together. So here's what I want you to do. Grab notes, and if you printed out notes for today from our website, fantastic. If you just have a blank piece of paper, that'll totally work. Napkin next to you, that'll work too. You can also do this on the app. Let me explain what we're about to do. As a kid, I actually loved going to the doctor. We went to the McGann Medical Clinic in Covina, California. And every time I went, I just loved it because they had one of these. Take a look at this. It's a Highlights magazine. Now, inside the magazine were pictures like this. I actually love these because of this. I love searching for the images in the pictures. And I love trying to find them faster than anyone else. I don't know what that says about me. I just had to find these. And while we played this game where how do you find these before your time in the waiting room is up? But sometimes I was really disappointed because I would show up to the doctor's office, open the magazine, and to my horror, some little juvenile delinquent went through and like circled all the places where the images showed up in the picture or colored them in. And I was like, what fun is that? The fun is not in someone else showing you where the treasure is in the picture. The fun is in you finding it for yourself, right? That was just me. It was so less satisfying having somebody else to do it for me. Here's my point. God's word, our Bibles, is a story of God's love and his faithfulness. It's a story how he offers us relationship with him, salvation from our sin, and eternal life at the end of this life. And the Bible gives us this picture that has so many hidden treasures, and God invites us to search and find these treasures in his word. And honestly, finding them for ourselves is way more satisfying than having someone do the work for us and just tell us about them. So here it is. The tool that I want to give you today is a tool about how to search God's word. And here's why this is so critical. A few moments ago, you saw this scripture read. It says this: the law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The decrees of the Lord are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They're sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. This scripture says an awful lot about the Bible. It's perfect, so you can trust it. It's a treasure full of wisdom. It's a source of joy, a determiner of direction, a light giver. It is valuable. It is sweet. It is caution giving, and it is rewarding. And this is just the tip of the iceberg about how life-changing it can be when you're able to read God's word for yourself and understand it. Do you need wisdom right now in your life for something? Do you want more joy, more direction? Do you want your hope to rise? Do you need caution because you're walking into dangerous territory? Do you want to see God reward you? I mean, these are all essentials to life, and they're found in God's word. But if you can't read it for yourself, then you are dependent on someone else for doing it for you. When my kids were young, I took my kids fishing. And it was actually, I think, more a test of my patience than it was anything. See, I would set up the poles. You feed the line through all the loops. You would tie on a hook. You'd put on weights. You'd put the bait on. And then I'd hand it to my kids. And they would cast it out somewhere, get it snagged. They would lose the hook, the weight, the tackle. And I would have to retie everything. When we went fishing, I brought at least one pole for everyone, including me. But all I ended up doing when I took my kids fishing was tying knots, getting tangles out, and they had all the fun fishing. And they would look at me at some moments like, Dad, hurry up, like tie the hook on. I got to get fishing again. One of these days, when you're old enough, you kids, you're going to learn how to tie these knots for yourselves. It's going to be a game changer. You're not going to rely on me so much, and that is going to be good for both of us, right? I mean, over the last, I don't know, 5-6 years, my son Austin, he's gotten really, really good at fishing. And so today when we go fishing, he's twice the fisherman I ever was. But now, instead of using that monofilament line, we use this stuff called braided line. And it requires a totally different knot. And I never looked it up on YouTube. I never learned how to tie it. So I'd be like, hey, Austin, I need you to tie this hook on my pole for me. And he would look at me like, are you kidding me? How old are you? Like, son, come on. I need you to tie that Palomar knot because I never learned it. And he would tie it. And as he's tying it, I would say, hey, listen, just think about it this way. You only owe me about 750 more knots until we're even. Here it is. You can live your life depending on other people to feed you God's word, or you can develop the skills to read God's word for yourself so you can find treasure for yourself, that you're not dependent on somebody else. That's the tool that I want to give you today. And I'll be honest with you, it's a game changer. It's a spiritual journey, spiritual maturity game changer. Here's the tool. You may have heard it before. It's called the SOAP method. So we're going to take a look at this together, but it will require some work on your part. So, hey, pull out a piece of paper, napkin, download the notes. There's going to be space for you to write on there, but I want you to write because you will get way more out of this if you're writing something down. So that's your fair warning. How do we get God's word inside our heart? It's called the SOAP method. S-O-A-P stands for scripture. The O stands for observation. The A stands for application, and the P stands for prayer. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a look at this scripture together. It's found in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. Then I'm going to skip down to chapter 2. And the scripture will show up on your screen here for just a moment. If you have your own Bible, that's great too. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. It reads like this. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. Now, drop down to chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. Now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. For time's sake, I had to take out a few verses between there. But here's your first activity. So you read that through once. You read through the scriptures. Here's what I want you to do. Whatever verse, whatever phrase, whatever word leapt off the page to you, like, well, that makes sense, or I get that, or that sounds powerful, I want you to write it down. Just put a big S right there, and then start writing down whatever verse, whatever word, whatever phrase jumped off the page to you, because that's where God, I believe, is focusing your attention. If you need to go through there again, read it again. Ready? We're going to read through it slowly one more time. Underline, highlight, and then eventually write down a word, a phrase, a sentence that God is bringing to your attention. Here it is one more time. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. Back down to verse 1, chapter 2. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. Now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. All right, what did you write down? What phrase grabbed your attention? Do it right now. Write this down. Maybe some of you wrote this. So that you have sincere love for each other. Maybe the thing about loving each other really jumped out to you. Maybe the phrase, therefore rid yourselves of all, and you're like, wow, to get rid of something, that seems super important. Maybe the all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Maybe that jumped out to you. Maybe when it said crave pure spiritual milk, you're like, I don't know what that is, but it seems really important to crave something. Maybe you wrote down, now that you've tasted that the Lord is good. So write something down. Don't write your own words. Write directly from Scripture. Here's the O. You ready? Observation. I want you to take a look at what you just wrote down and write down what you think it means. I mean, what are the observations about the text? Focus on the words that you wrote. What did the author mean to say? He's an author writing to an audience. What was he trying to communicate? You could paraphrase the text in your own words. You could outline it. You could ask questions for clarity about it. Just, you can't do this. Ready? You can't write I, me, or my. Because if you say, I think it's, well, no. What did the author mean? What did Peter mean to say? Me or my? You can't use that because then it's application. Don't apply it to your life. Just write what your observations are about what the truth is. All right, we'll get into application in the next section. So here's a couple examples. Maybe if you wrote down, so that you have sincere love for each other. Maybe you wrote that because it seemed like this is the overarching theme, to love each other, and you notice that loving each other had two parts, getting rid of something and craving something or feeding yourself something. You notice that love isn't described as a feeling, but as an action, getting rid of something specific. And actually getting rid of, it said, all malice. I mean, that was significant. And then feeding yourself spiritual truth. Maybe you wrote down this phrase, all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander of every kind. Maybe you didn't even know what malice was. So you're like, I better go look that up. And you asked Siri and you wrote down what malice was. Maybe once you found the definition, you're like, well, if those are the negatives that you're getting rid of, what if I actually applied the positives to it? So maybe you went through and you wrote malice down, and then the opposite of malice would be like goodwill towards someone. Instead of wanting evil for them, you want good for them. For deceit, you're going to replace deceit with honesty, telling the truth. Maybe you're going to replace hypocrisy with authenticity, or envy with contentment, or slander with, get this, encouragement. You're attempting to write what the Bible is meaning, what the author's trying to communicate. All right, did you write something? Look around each other. I mean, if you're watching this by yourself, you know, I was hoping you'd be with somebody, but just look at each other's stuff and say, hey, you wrote something down. If someone is just, they're not writing something down, just shame them right now, okay? Just straight up shame them, all right? S, scripture. O, observation. Here we go. The A is application. If you know what the Bible says and then what it means, then the question becomes this. What do you do about it? How does this apply to your life? So I want you to try and answer these three questions. What are you going to do? When will you do it? And with whom will you do it? Once you look at what the Bible means, how do you actually do this? Maybe you're evaluating. I mean, how have I recently done these things of like malice and slander, and that you're saying, maybe I've done something there, and I need to make that right, and so there's an action. If your text is about craving pure spiritual milk, then maybe you have an action related to feeding yourself spiritually so that you can grow. What's the action? See, here's where people make a mistake in this all the time. When it comes to application, people sometimes, they just write down another truth. I don't want you to just learn another truth. We're searching, we've already found the truth, right? Now we're saying, how do I live this out? The reason this is so critical is that Jesus said things like this, like in Matthew 7:24. Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, he's like a wise man who built his house on a rock. We want to be those wise people who are applying God's word. So the final part of this is prayer. It's your conversation with God. So would you do this? Write a P. And then write out a short prayer based off of what you just learned and what you're going to do. Write your prayer out. You don't have to write the whole prayer out. Some of y'all pray long, right? Don't write your whole prayer. Just write a summary of your prayer. You could be thanking God for something or asking him for something. Write it down. All right, we're almost done. You've done the S-O-A-P. You've done the soap, and you've heard from God and seen what the Bible says. You're applying it to your life, and you're praying. And this is how I spend time with God every single morning. But before you're done, here it is. I want you to write a title. Put a title at the very top, right above the S, and I want you to pick 2, 3, 4 words and create a title that summarizes what it is that God showed you today. I'll show you why that's so important in just a minute. The SOAP method is taught in a book called The Divine Mentor. It's written by a guy by the name of Wayne Cordero. Fantastic book. I highly recommend it to you. But instead of buying that book, here's the jump I want all of us to make this week. The SOAP method has actually been put into a journal called the Life Journal. This is mine right here. In this book is all the record of my entries for this year. And here's what's great. We actually bought life journals for everyone that you can purchase from us, okay? We're going to explain at the end of the service today how you can get one of these. But let me just walk you through my life journal. When you open this up, there's an explanation of the SOAP method. So if I didn't do it clearly today, it's going to be right in here. When you turn over the instructions, now you get this table of contents. Get this. This table of contents has the date I read it, the scripture I read, and then the title that I gave that. Here's why the table of contents is so fantastic. Back on February 26th of this year, I was reading Exodus 17, and I had a journal entry that day that was called Hands Up. It was, and I'll explain it this way. What if someone asked you how they could become a mature Christian? Or they said, hey, I want you to disciple me. Would you know how to do it? I would, because of Exodus 17 that I titled Hands Up. Because on that day, God made it really clear from a story in scripture on what it takes for someone to grow in Christ and how I can help them. You see, this table of contents right here is a rich treasure of what it is that God revealed to me. I wouldn't trade this thing for anything. And then a couple pages over, there's actually a reading plan for the whole year. On here is you can read through the whole Bible in 1 year, or there's a shorter version, an express version, we'll call it, of the same thing. So here's what I want you to do. At the end of the service, we'll explain how to get a life journal. I want every single one of people in our church to get a life journal. And next Sunday, when we launch this series called Made Away in the Book of Exodus, we're going to soap our way through the Book of Exodus. Here's my desire, that we're all going to do this for this reason, so that we can all grow up, so that we can all become mature followers of Christ. Because this is my guess about an awful lot of us. We accepted Christ, became Christians, and as Peter says, we tasted that the Lord is good. But somewhere in the midst of there, we stopped. When it says that we were born again, when you're born again a baby. You're not born into spiritual maturity. We go to church 2.3 times a month, right? We listen to the message, and we're mature because we even fill in the blanks, right, with the notes. We attend a community group, do a service project a couple times a year. But listen, when you look in the mirror, you would not consider yourself spiritually mature. Because when you were born again, you were born as a baby, but you never grew past maybe that infant stage or maybe that teenager stage. In our world, you know what a mature adult does? They're actually able to parent a kid up towards maturity. They train a human being to be a responsible adult. Here's a question for you to consider. What if someone walked up to you today and asked, would you disciple me? Would you help me grow to become spiritually mature? I just became a Christian. I don't know anything about Jesus. My knowledge of the Bible is totally limited. But for 1 year, listen, I'm going to do whatever you tell me to do. I'm totally committed. Here's the question. Would you know what to do with that person? My dream for our church is this, that we have an entire church of people who would know what to do because they're skilled in how to use this tool. See, here's the mistake that some Christians make. Someone asks you to help them find the treasure in God, in Christ, find the treasure in the world, and here's what, in the Word, but you just give them the treasure that you found previous. Instead of teaching them the thrill of how to search through God's word for themselves. We make the mistake of tying the knot for them instead of teaching them how to tie the knot for themselves so that they don't need to rely on us anymore. If your method for helping a person grow makes them dependent on you instead of making them dependent on God, can I suggest that you might need a new method? Parents, let me tell you this. This is the greatest gift we've given our kids. It's a tool that will help them not rely on us and them needing us for the rest of our lives. It's a tool that teaches them to rely on God and God's word. So listen, if you're a person of influence, you have influence with people. If you're a person who has known Jesus for a long time, do you know how to help someone grow spiritually? The greatest gift you can give them is a tool so that they can feed themselves spiritually. All right, let's wrap this up. Today, we're going to teach you how to get a life journal. Grab a life journal this week. Next Sunday, we're going to kick off the journey made away in the book of Exodus. By the way, is there anything before we finish that God invited you to do in his word? Something to get rid of, something to feed yourself, or a person that you need to love? Let's not pretend like that was a fruitless exercise. That was something that God showed you this morning. Go live that out. Go do that. Go apply that, and your life is going to be on a firm foundation. Let's pray. God, thanks for your word that is such a treasure for us. Even when we don't value it sometimes, it is an amazing treasure. So God, would you open our eyes to who you are in your word? Help us to diligently exercise this new tool that we have. And God, as we gather next week to celebrate 150 years, can we just say thank you for how good you've been to us? We love you. And we thank you, Jesus, and we pray that you would keep changing people's lives. Change our lives. We love you, Jesus, in your name. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. God, I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. Oh, I have been. Good. goodness of God.
Hey, thanks for joining us today. If you need to get a hold of Church on the Hill for any reason, if you need prayer, you have questions about what we do, or maybe this is your first time with us, we'd love to know that you joined us here today. So use our email address, info@churchonthehill.com. That's info@churchonthehill.com. That's a great way just to get a hold of us. Now, today is Mother's Day, so dads, I hope that's not a surprise to you. And we did a great contest where we had kids submit videos about how much they love their mom. And the winner is Drizelle Palma. Check out this video.
Oh, 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 oh.
We know you love us. We know you care, just shout whenever, and you'll be there. You are our love, you're in our hearts, and you will never, ever, ever be apart.
All right, great job, kids. That was an amazing video. We know that you love your mom, and because of that, you're going to get Famous Dave's Barbecue for lunch today. So that is going to be on the way in just a little bit. Famous Dave's Barbecue, what could be better for Mother's Day? Hey, you just heard about our life journals, and so I want to give you some details on how you're going to get those. So first off, go to the churchonthehill.com website. You'll see a link there to purchase the life journals. And this is for anybody in high school on up. We want anybody in high school on up to get a life journal and be part of using the SOAP method to study the Bible. And then we're going to have two pickups this coming week, Friday from 4 to 6, Friday the 15th between 4 and 6, or Sunday the 17th between 2 and 4. So go online, buy your journal, and then come by this next week and pick up your journals on Friday and or Sunday. Hey, right now we're going to give our morning offering. So if you would grab your phone and text COTH to 77977 or go to our website, let's join in together in giving this morning. Hey, you know what? Happy Mother's Day, and thank you for joining us today. We will see you next Sunday.